Well, good afternoon to everybody, and I want to welcome you to our time of memorial, a time of honor and remembrance today. Thank you all for coming and for being here this afternoon. We are gathering to celebrate the life of David Tyler Carpenter. And just again, a greeting to everyone. Special prayers for all the family. We have been praying for you and for all of the friends as this is a hard time. Thanks so much to a number from the military, some who traveled quite a distance, I believe, to be here today. So thank you for being here to be a part of this time of memorial. And as we are all aware, David was taken so suddenly from this earth at only 38 years of age. Because of these difficult circumstances, our hearts are very heavy today, and we need God's comfort and peace more than ever. I pray that the Lord would use this time of honor and remembrance today to bring that peace to each one of us who are gathered here. We certainly miss David, but because of David's commitment to Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior, the sadness and the sorrow that we experience is eclipsed by the joy and the hope of knowing that David is in heaven today and rejoicing in ways we can't even imagine. But still, our hearts here are heavy. And the Lord wants to help with that heaviness. The Lord wants to help with that grief that we feel today. So I pray our time of sharing together and the things that we're going to see and hear today will encourage our hearts. So with that blessed hope firmly planted in our hearts, let's go to the Lord in prayer and let's ask him to guide our service today. Will you pray with me? Father, as we come today, we are grateful for the opportunity to gather like this. We know as family and friends come together over hard times that you can bring great healing. And you can use just the presence of others even to bring a peace and a comfort, and a hug and a handshake can really go a long way. So we're grateful, Lord, that we can be here today, that we can gather and have this memorial. But Lord, in the midst of our gathering, we have the pain and we have the sorrow and we have the grief. And Father, you are up to handling all of those emotions that we experience today. And so my prayer as we begin our time to remember David and his life is that your spirit will be in this place in such a powerful way that we would even sense your comfort. We would sense your peace. And Lord, that you would come upon us with that measure of comfort that only you can today. So Lord, we ask your blessing upon our time, your guidance upon our time, and that Lord, not only would David in his memory be honored, but Lord, we will also want to honor and glorify you as we come together today. So we pray this all in the precious name of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. As we begin today, I would like you to listen to God's word from the prophet Jeremiah. And the family chose these couple of verses, and I love these verses. Listen to them and hear God's word this afternoon. And God is speaking to us. He says, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. Then you will call on me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart." That's what we want to do at our service for David today. We want to call on the Lord. We want to seek him with the wonderful promise that we will find him. And I love that if we will seek after him, God doesn't play hide and seek where he's going to hide from us. He will be there for you. He will be there for me today. And so that's what we want to do this afternoon. He is here for each of us to provide the hope we need in difficult times. I want to share with you a tribute to David's life that his parents wrote. David grew up in Springfield, Oregon. David was an incredibly happy child, and he loved having fun with his friends and his family. He loved camping, fishing, and hunting. Our family vacations to Black Butte Ranch every summer with his cousins Stephanie and Kimberly, Aunt Pam and Uncle Bob, sleepovers at Grandma Connie's house with his cousins, riding ATVs at the coast, going to Disneyland, and many other adventures. He was full of life, and his sense of humor was so fun. There was a lot of laughter in our house because of him. David and his childhood best friend, Gaston, were inseparable. Always together, they enjoyed hunting, riding their ATVs, taking judo lessons, camping, and many other activities. In high school, David volunteered with the Mohawk Valley Fire Department and enjoyed it very much, especially when his mentor, Dennis Flanders, let him drive the fire truck. I could see that being a highlight. David learned his work ethic early in life. He started as a wash boy at Carpenter Trucking when he was 12 years old, going to work every Saturday with his dad. He loved going to work with his dad and always gave it 110%. He felt since he was the boss's kid, he had better show the other guys what he was made of. His dad liked calling him Junior, and it stuck for the rest of his life. He was proud to be called Junior, and that is what most people called him. He grew up working at the truck shop, learning how to work on trucks, and many of his friends ended up working alongside of him. Eventually, he drove log truck for his dad, and they turned his sights on working in the woods. He started as a chaser, then a choker setter, eventually learning to be a hook tender, timber faller, and loader operator. David loved the woods and being outdoors. Logging was his passion. He started his own logging company, Carpenter Logging, and he excelled at it. He worked alongside his best friends, Gaston, Big Jim, and Turbo. Those boys had such a good time together, and they worked so hard. He married his high school sweetheart, Danielle, and together they had two beautiful children, Talia and Wyatt, his pride and joy. Later they divorced and David joined the United States Army and was the 173rd Airborne Brigade. He loved being a paratrooper sky soldier and was an expert marksman. David excelled in the Army and he loved his country and he wanted to make a career of it. He was deployed to Afghanistan, and sadly, his truck was blown up by a roadside IED, injuring him badly, which resulted in having both legs amputated. The Army sent him to Fort Sam Houston in San Antonio, Texas, so he could have the best medical care. He medically retired from the military and was currently residing in Clarksville, Tennessee. He devoted himself to being a full-time stay-at-home dad with his twin two-year-old sons, Jace and Colt. David's children were everything to him, and he loved them so very much. So many wonderful memories of our son, and these are just a few. We were so immensely proud of him. He was our heart and soul. The love we have for our son is immeasurable, and we will miss him so much each day. He was our greatest joy. We will see you again, son, and know you are in heaven with our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We will see David again. We will see him again. This is the hope of all who know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. God's word records a talk between Jesus and his disciples, and it's in John chapter 14. It goes like this. Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God. Believe it also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I am going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. "You know the way to the place where I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we don't know where you're going. So how can we know the way?" And Jesus answered, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." David believed that Jesus was the way, the truth, and the life. And he made a commitment to God many years ago, and he realized that he needed Jesus. I had numerous opportunities to talk with David about the Lord while he was a part of Camp Creek Church and part of a college and career Bible study that we had with about 30-some people that used to come to that study. And I know about, you know, his walk with the Lord and his desire to serve the Lord. But he believed in Jesus. Not just there was a Jesus, but Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. David realized that he needed Jesus. You know, we all need Jesus. Maybe you wonder why. Because we were created by God. All of us were, to have a relationship with him. But those things that we do wrong, that they separate us from God. And to satisfy God's holiness, to satisfy God's righteousness, a penalty had to be paid. And rather than have us pay that penalty, God in his love and mercy paid it by allowing his son, Jesus Christ, to die in our place on the cross of Calvary. And he bridged the gap that our sin created. And in Jesus' death, our sins were taken care of. And in his resurrection, our victory over the grave was won. Forgiveness, new life, hope beyond the grave. Those are some reasons why we need Jesus. And those are some amazing benefits that come to all who believe in what Jesus did and who will accept him as their Savior. Again, I say, because of David's commitment to Jesus, he is in heaven today. And you know, sometimes when we use that word hope and we say we're hoping in this or that, it's not a very sure thing. Like all of us are enjoying this nice weather, but we hope it rains. You know, you see what I mean? We hope it rains, but it's not a sure thing. However, when I talk about hope in Jesus, it is a sure thing. It is an assurance beyond any shadow of doubt that what God says in his word will come true. That's why I can assure you today with the hope that David, because of his commitment to Christ, is with the Lord today. I want to share with you a letter written by David's dad, Scott. And this letter, Scott, by the way, was the impetus for my piece in The Way, the Truth, and the Life. As I read that, I thought, that's what we're going to talk about today. This is what the letter says. "We are a Christian family who believes that Christ Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. We believe in the Trinity, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. This is the same faith we brought to our son, David Tyler Carpenter. On July 3rd, David's soul went to be with his Lord and Savior, Jesus. We know where he is, and he awaits our reunion with him. In this urn is David's mortal husk, which has spent 38 years, he spent 38 years using while occupying his time and space here on earth. A temporary home, if you will. But what about David's life here on earth? Where can we find his 38 years of life? The answer is simple. David's life lives in each and every one of you here today, along with those who could not attend. Anyone who spent any time with him carries a part of his 38 years. Whether a brief time or one that spanned many years of his life is in you, it is in all of us, and it is our honor and duty to keep David's life with us, to ponder, to share, and to memorialize. Even with him not being here with us physically, collectively, all together, we make up David's life here on earth. We are the word, the sentence, the paragraph, the chapter, the book, which spans from February 6, 1983 to July 3, 2021. Knowing David as well as we did makes us all family brought together by him and him alone. David was a beloved son, fun and entertaining cousin, a good friend, and a brother in arms. As we continue our own journeys in this life, please take your part of David's 38 years and keep it alive in your hearts and in your minds. We grieve today, and we will continue to do so, but please allow his memory to live on in us forever. We thank you all for your love and support. Thank you, Scott, for sharing those words. And I love that whole piece about that legacy that has been given to us by David, that we can continue on as we live out those things that he valued in his life. I know that as Scott shared some memories in that writing, and he and Tammy both shared some memories in the tribute that I read about David's life, we all have memories of David. Unfortunately, we don't have time to share all those memories here today, but we can spend a few moments and sharing some, reflecting, laughing maybe, crying, listening. So we want to take some time to share some memories at this point. And so what I normally do, and it works out really nicely, is you don't have to come up front unless you want to, but I can bring the microphone to you, and I do ask that you use the microphone. As it just helps everybody hear what's going on. So I would love to hear from any memories or stories that someone might like to share. And again, if you just raise your hand, I'll come to you. Or if you don't mind coming up in front, you're welcome to do that as well.
I would just like to tell Scott, Tammy, and all the family how much he was loved by all of us. But I'm so happy for him because he's at total peace because he does know God, and he went to be in a much happier place.
Thank you. Someone else have a memory or story you might like to share?
When I first got to Germany, me and David had never actually met, and I grew up in Eugene, he grew up in Springfield, but he just was a really good friend to me, and I was going through a pretty rough time being away from my family, and I missed him a lot.
Thank you. Are any other memories? We have Bob and then.
So, David, as most of you know, probably loved to hunt, and so do I. So, and used to go over to Eastern Oregon a lot, shoot sage rats, and I took David with me one time, and so we shot rats during the day, and then we actually had the opportunity that night to have permission from the rancher, and we got to shoot some rabbits around the alfalfa field, which the rancher loved because they eat a lot of alfalfa. And so we would drive around these circles, and you see, you know, in the summertime it doesn't get dark till 10, so we drive around and shoot, and then by the time you got all the way around the field, you could turn right around and go back. So it got to be 11 o'clock, got to be 12 o'clock, and it's like, well, maybe we should think about going home, back to Lapine. And, just one more time, you know, so we'd go back around one more time. maybe just one more time. and I'm not sure what time we got back in the middle of the night sometime, but that's one of the memories that I have with David. We had a great time over in Eastern Oregon shooting and got to take him. You know, he was quite a bit younger then, so it was a lot of fun, and I'll always have that memory. I heard something about marksmanship here, and I know where he got part of that from was from shooting a lot. And one other time we were on the edge of the field shooting at sage rats, and another thing the ranchers don't like is badgers, because they dig up their field really bad, and the equipment hits in these big holes and stuff. And so we always had permission to get rid of the badgers too. And we saw movement on the side of the field, and I put the binoculars up, and I had not seen a badger before, but I said, "It's a badger." And I wasn't looking at David, but evidently he already had his gun up and ready to go, because I said, "Take him." And I no more got out of my mouth than it was like, bang, and the badger was toast. So anyway, that's some memories I had of David being with him, getting to shoot and hunt and have fun.
Thank you, Bob.
Several years ago, I was asked to come to Briggs Middle School and talk about Vietnam and what it meant to me. I was there twice. After the first time, I met with the principal, and I told him about David losing his legs. I came back the second time to see a memorial in the trophy case with David in it. That's fine.
Because he was a student.
Yes.
Briggs. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Right. Right. Very neat. Good. Thank you, Pat, for sharing that. Are there others that have? Yes.
I'm David's aunt. I just wanted to share the thing I remember most about him is his enthusiasm. Everything he did, he was so enthusiastic about it. He went with all his heart. And I know when he was thinking about going into the military, my stepdad was a career Air Force, and he came over and he was grilling him for hours about the service and the different aspects of it. But he was just always so enthusiastic.
Thank you.
When David started washing trucks, he was pretty young, as we were all, but Scott told me, don't be easy on him. So I duct taped him to a pole. And I told him I wouldn't let him out of there until he sang, "I'm a little teapot." He didn't know all the words, but after a while, I felt bad for him because he said he had to go to the bathroom. But Dave was a great friend, and he could always make me laugh.
Brandon, only if you had a cell phone to record that, you know? They didn't know, that's what I'm saying, if you did.
Well, so I deployed with David. I would have to say that my best, more non-pleasant memory was when we were deployed together. And he's probably the toughest guy I ever met, honestly. The night that the incident happened, there was not one time that I even faced him. We already knew the consequences and what was gonna happen after the incident, yet that never faced him. And you know, as a young team leader that I was back then, you know, just watching, like, his demeanor after this, I mean, I was scared shitless. And here I have this guy just as tough as nails, you know, that knows what's going to happen in the future, and yet it's not facing him. And then when he got, you know, like later on in Fort Sam Houston, he still had the same demeanor. He was just the toughest individual I've ever met. And, you know, extremely positive. You know, he lost the first leg. And then I talked to him a few months later, and then he told me he was going to have the other leg, and it just never faced him. He was just looking for the next. He was all excited about his new leg and how he still wanted to be in the Army. And I was like, absolutely, man. You know, like, and I just want to say, like, you guys have probably, like, the toughest guy as a father that I've ever met.
Thank you so much for sharing that. And thank all of our military here for their service to our nation, for sure. Well, we have time for a couple of more if there's someone that would like to share something. And we will be having a reception on the church grounds back over that direction after we finish in here. And oftentimes, if you don't feel like sharing in front of everybody here, you can maybe come to some of the family and share a memory. They would love to hear some of those stories and memories that you may have of David. But is there another couple that we would want to do before we move on?
Hi. My husband went to Germany, and it took a while for family members to go. So the married soldiers had to wait in the barracks for us. It took us about 5 or 6 months. It was a long time. And my husband called me and told me how he met this guy that was from his same town. He was really excited about that. Mm-hmm. And I heard a lot about David, and then me and my daughter flew out to Germany, and we got reunited finally. And it took a little bit longer for David's family to go out there. And David, wanting to get out of the barracks too, would come and hang out with us almost every night. And we would stay up all late, and we would have dinner and stuff, and all he talked about was his kids. That's all he talked about. And how excited he was that they were gonna come out here sometime. And I just wanted you guys to know that's all he talked about, and he loved you guys so much. And I heard a lot about his mother. And I heard a lot about Danielle. And I just, he loved all you guys very much.
Thank you for sharing that. That's great.
You can throw a football, too.
Okay. Very good. Awesome. Anyone else? Those are some great memories, great stories. Those are so important to, you know, go through those and even share those with one another. Like I say, this is can be a very healing time that God can use in our lives at a difficult moment, and so can our time afterwards. So I'm encouraging you to stay after if you can and be able to mingle with one another and share more of those memories and those things that you think about when you think of David. There were a couple of pictures of David that were on the screens as you came in. They're the same photos that are there on your memorial flyer today. Some great, great photos. And we want to view some more of those pictures now. I just want to thank everyone who provided photos of David and his life, and to Danielle for putting those together in a slideshow and a tribute to him. And so we want to view that at this point, a special slideshow tribute to David and his life.
Oh, 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 give me Jesus. the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, oh, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, oh, give me Jesus. All I need is worship you. We worship you. Say we worship you, Lord. You're the answer to my prayers. You're the calm in the storm. You're my rest and my refuge.
Give me Jesus. That's what we grab a hold of. That's what we hang on to during these difficult times, to have Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior in our own lives and those that we love, so that one day we will see them again. Wonderful tribute. Thank you, Danielle, for putting that slideshow together. And just thank you all who sent in photos and pictures that could be included in that. It's amazing. I was talking to Scott before the service today just about the idea that they were such a part of the church family here for years. This is a fitting place to have the memorial for David. And as I view the pictures again, there were a number of them that took place here. And to see just how David impacted our community of faith right here, and hopefully how we impacted his life as well, is an amazing thing. And so we're glad to view those together today. Again, this verse that we began our service with, listen to it in light of some of the things we've talked about today. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and future. Then you will call on me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. Let's just take a moment to seek him before we round out our service today. Will you bow with me? Father, we've spent some time talking about David's life and hearing some stories and memories that have been shared by family and friends. We've viewed these pictures today, these photographs, and just hearing that wonderful song in the background, Give Me Jesus. Lord, you promise us in your word that we will find you if we seek you. And so, Lord, we are asking today that we might just find you very clearly in this moment and in this time. And so we are grateful, Father, for that now, and just for an opportunity to, in our own hearts, call upon you and allow you to come in and bring us peace and comfort right now, encouragement right now, and just the opportunity to receive all that you have for us today in this place. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. As you know, David was definitely a part of the United States Army and served faithfully and very sacrificially in that place. And so we today look forward to military honors for him that will be here soon. The gentlemen that were here quite early today misplaced a couple of things, I guess, and are supposed to be back here very soon to close out our service. So we want to close out in that way. But I am so grateful for the service that David shared in our country and the sacrifice that he made on our behalf. And we remember that today, and just so good to have some of the comrades that served with him to be there today. So we do want to close out our services with that. But again, I'm just kind of waiting for them to get back, as they had a little difficulty with some things. And so we'll be here very soon. So So I'm going to one more time say, is there any last thoughts or memories that you might like to share? Because we really want to include the piece of the military as we close our service. But I'd be glad to bring the mic around, or if there's anyone that has something else you'd like to share today, this is a great time. Yes, good. Otherwise, you might have to hear me go on and on and on until the armed forces enters the door back there. So thank you.
Hi, everyone. I'm Gaston Arnold's mom, Katie. And I first met David when I came home one day. And there was a little three-year-old boy sitting in my garage. I'd never seen him before. So I asked Gaston, who was also little, do you know that boy? No, mommy. Okay. So I got out, and he climbed on Gaston's hobby horse. And he was riding like that thing for all it was worth. And I knew that I was in love with this little boy. He was a constant in our lives. If there was an accident, David was there. He saved Gaston's life in a logging accident. He was just the most joyful and happy person I've ever known. And he was a light that will shine always in our hearts.
Thank you. Must have been a surprise to see that little boy out there. That's great. Thank you for sharing that. Are there any others that would like to share? Would you want to? Well, okay, let's do that then. That sound good? Because we want to do our militaries. Again, I apologize that I'm sorry. I'm not sure all the details that happened with our gentlemen that were here, but they assure me they will be back. So let's view that again. That was a great, great picture. So let's watch that one more time.
Oh, 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 give me Jesus. In the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, oh, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, oh, give me Jesus. When I come. give me Jesus. All I need, we worship you. We worship you. Say we worship you, Lord. You're the answer to my prayers. You're the calm in the storm. You're my rest and my refuge.
That was good to see that again. That was good. And it just those great memories that are there are so important. Well, our military folks are not back yet from the deal that they had to do. I would really like to have that as a part of our service today. I'm very sorry for whatever has transpired that caused them to not be able to come back. So I don't know if you want to spend a little more time sharing in hopes that they would come, or we could also go out for our reception, and they are prepared to do something like that for everybody outside, but it's just a hard call because it's such a special part of the service to have that done. He does. I think it's great, and I think if everybody's fine, you know, waiting, that is fine with me too. Okay, well, we will do that. We will do that. I told you a little bit about when David was here with a lot of other college and career-aged young people and a Bible study that we used to have. It was an amazing, amazing time to be a part of that. It was a part of he and Danielle's wedding here at Camp Creek Church, and some of those special memories. And all those things that you have shared today were so true about him. And he was just a prince of a guy to visit with. I mean, I love that piece about him, to be able to just share and talk with him. And he was always so polite and so gracious. And I know that, you know, he was, quote, the rough logger background, you know, I get that. But you'd never know it, and when he would visit with me, just love that about him. And I know when I knew David, it's been a while now since I have seen him and been able to visit with him, but the Lord did shine through in his life, and his desire to serve God was a very important piece of his life, and he is enjoying the very presence of Jesus today because of that. And what a testimony, even all of you who could come out today. And I know there's many more that would have been here, but just it's summertime, there's miles to travel and lots of things that prevent folks from gathering. But I just thank you all for coming and having a part in this today and to remember David and his life. It was interesting, too. I told you, if you're not going to talk, I will. It was interesting, too, because I thought, you know, I mean, I know, and it's just interesting how you see things change over the years. A lot of times when you have sharing at these services, the whole service can be sharing. But it's hard sometimes to share. It's hard to stand up and to share those memories in front of people. So I said, you know what? I'm just going to have a much shorter message today to allow for that. So I should have just prepared that long, you know, message. I have several points from the 23rd Psalm, you know, if you want to hear them. No, I just, like I shared when I read Scott's tribute and his letter, that gave me what I was going to talk about, that Jesus, when Scott said we're a Christian family, we believe that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, I said, there you go. That's what we're going to talk about, that him being the way, the truth, and the life. And So that was neat to see. So I didn't make much of a sermon because you kind of preached it for me there, and that was awesome. But I do think that's great. Oh, we've got someone that wants to share. He's a preacher, too. I know this gentleman. Yeah. Would you like to come up? I figured you wouldn't mind. Thank you.
My name is Gabe, and I figure we need at least one login story today.
Good, so. Good.
So when I met Junior, I was the FNG on the crew, and he was the boss. And so I was following him around the mountain like a puppy dog, just trying to learn how to log. And he was such a great teacher. And one morning, we got an early start, and we're down in this woebegone canyon in the Cascades, and it's super thick brush. And we're sitting down there, and we're tinkering on some block. And all of a sudden, we both get quiet, and we hear this like rustling of leaves about 30 feet away. And we don't think anything of it. And then we hear it over here, and then we hear it over here. And then he stops, and I stop, and we both look at each other. And at the same exact time, both our eyes went, and we both said at the same time, "Bigfoot." And I'm like, "Oh, it's got to be him." And so we get super quiet. And it's getting closer and closer, but we can't see it. And the branches are moving in this one area. And he's like, "You go look. I'm not looking. You go look. I'm not looking." So these big, tough logger guys are like trying to goad each other into be the one that tiptoes towards the sound and see if it's actually Bigfoot. And we finally, back to back, we're kind of scooching closer and closer, and we get to where we can see the brush moving, and we can hear the sound, and it sounds like some big thing moving through the timber. And so we're like, "It's right there. Oh my gosh, we're going to see Bigfoot." And he's like, "What do we do? What do we do?" And I said, "Well, let's remember everything in detail because we could press out here." And we honestly thought it was Bigfoot. And we finally barrel through. We're going to charge and see if we can spook Bigfoot out. And it was a little tiny creek in the bottom of the drainage where it was filling up as a pool, and then splashing over the top and through some ferns, and then filling up and splashing through the top of some ferns. And so we left a little rejected, but from that day forward, every time I think I'm hearing or seeing Bigfoot in the woods, I always think of that moment when Junior and I were the closest I've ever been to Bigfoot.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Thank you, Gabe, for sharing that. I love that. There is a lot of talk of Bigfoot, you know, so they came really close to seeing it. That's very cool. I believe our military folks are on their way to being right here, so we're glad, and I appreciate the thought that David deserves to have that tribute, and so we'll wait for that tribute to happen, right? So thank you all for your patience in this, and glitches do come up. That's part of life, and not everything comes about just as we would like sometimes, but you know, I do believe with God there is a reason in it all. Maybe we needed to hear the Bigfoot story today, and we wouldn't have heard that before. Maybe we needed to see those slides again. Once wasn't enough. God always has a reason. But I am grateful for the tribute that we can share together with our military as they get set up for that. And again, I do want to share with you that afterwards, there's all kinds of goodies and refreshments provided by the family outdoors. We'd love to encourage you to be a part of that. It's probably warm out there, but if I engineered it correctly, working with the Lord and the shade he provided, all the tables will be in the shade is what my thought is. So I hope they are, and I know it will be a nice time of healing and sharing together at that point. I enjoy also, and if you didn't get a chance to see them more closely, maybe after the service you can come up to see some of the medals that are here. That David has, and to see those before you today. It's great to have that. I know that military piece is a big piece. I didn't. So how long's your hand been up there? Just now, okay. Because my father was in the Army. He was in World War II, and all of those medals and things that he has, and I don't know, knick-knack is not the appropriate word for them, but some of the things that he brought back, very special. You know, very special to go over those. And I know I wish I would have spent more time talking to him about what some of those things were all about. And I know some folks here from the church know more about what my dad did than I do because they talked to him about some of those military experiences. But it is a special part. And if you have family that have served in the military, it is a part of your life in one way or another. Danielle.
I got to get raised by these two amazing people as well. And I spent a lot of time in that truck shop, learned how to try to catch a U-joint as it flies across the shop when it pops out of our 76 high boy that we had constantly. That was just silly. But I don't want to say a whole lot because I'm going to have a hard time. But one thing that I wanted to say talking about logging was I'll never forget when David tipped our shovel over. And he calls me and he tells me what happened. And I don't remember all of the details, but he just tells me that, well, I dumped the shovel over. And I was like, what? How did you do that? And he was just like, I don't remember all the details. I just what I really remember about that is how many trucks it took to pull the thing back over. And then getting phone calls within 2 hours because log truckers have CB radios and they talk real fast. And I remember getting text messages and phone calls asking if Junior was okay. And I was like, yeah, he's okay. How do you know? You know, log truckers talk. So, that's all I wanted to say. And thank you guys for everybody who's here. It's you guys were all a part of our life. And even the ones that I haven't got to meet, thank you for your part in his. He's like one of the best things in the whole world. And I'm grateful that I have these two kids. And I get to have a part of him forever.
I'm not going to stand up. I'm just going to stare straight ahead. But you
do that.
I'm Kimberly.
Whatever you'd like.
Cousin, and he was our only first cousin that was our age. So he was my little brother, even though he was like 8 months older than me. But I remember one story. I think we were like five. I don't even know. But I was pushing him in a stroller because he was that little brother that I never had. And down our driveway, and there was these little red berries. And I was like, oh, look, little red berries. Let's have some. And so we both ate them. And this was before Google. So it took like hours for my mom to figure out what we ate. And they had to give us stuff to make us throw up. Then they were fine, but we had already thrown up anyways. So that was one of the many fun stories. Lots of great memories. Bike riding, swimming in the pool. Share a love of riding three-wheelers. And I remember the pine. You know, oh, he was crazy, and I just hold on for dear life, beloved every second. He'd take it up on two wheels, and I don't know if I ever told Mom, but it was, like, so fun, and I, you know, you feel like you're going to fall over, but we never did, and, yeah, and we always, you know, called each other cuz, and what do we say? Love you, cuz.
I'm David's aunt. I will expound a little bit on the Ipecac story. I was outside actually with the kids when they were playing and they came and said, we ate some red berries. And I'm like, where? So they showed them to me. They were fine. They were just rose hips. They were fine, but I needed to make sure. So I get the number on the bottle and I call and they said, well, to be safe, you should probably give them Ipecac. So I gave it to Kimberly and David. Kimberly threw up on command, basically. David, being a little tougher, the kid did not. He would not. And I thought, what am I going to do? Well, I found another half a bottle. Still, no action. And I'm like, oh no. So I actually had to put the poor little guy on a swing on the swing set and swing him. the greatest aunt ever. Anyway, they had great times together. We had great times That's together, awesome. But I'm that was a very interesting story.
And I, being the oldest cousin, could not figure out why on earth my mom wanted them to throw up. As my sister said, David was really our little brother. The three of us were really close growing up. Even in the last several years, with him moving around, we still text and still always say, love you, cuz, no matter where he was. And One funny thing that might not be known about David, and I'm trying to decide if he would be really mad that I'm sharing this. But it's funny, and we have some time, so. Is it okay? David was a sleepwalker, big time, like scary big time. He'd sleepwalk and he would move all over in his sleep, and we'd have sleepovers all the time. Us three cousins at our house and Aunt Tim's grandma's house. Wherever David started, you would know that's not where he would end up in the morning. And you had to give him a lot of room. I found him under my bed the next morning. He would sleep down flights of stairs even and not wake up. And I remember a couple times house sitting for Aunt Tammy and Uncle Scott, and David was there, and literally you had to sleep with one eye open because he would sleepwalk into where you were sleeping and then just stand there because he was sleeping. Talk about a scary wake-up call. So you'd have to kind of talk to him, wake him up. It was always an adventure. He, like my sister shared, he those three-wheeler rides, and if we got far enough away from the A-frame in Lapine, Mom and Aunt Tammy couldn't see us, so that's when he'd really kick it up a notch. And we'd always tell him, faster, faster, and he happily obliged. And and we'd be around there, and he let us drive a couple times, yeah. But we mostly liked to ride because he'd go fast. But those are some real fun memories. And I was fortunate enough to be able to visit him in Germany, and I just want to say thank you over here to this front row and all of you guys that are here and couldn't be here. We got to see a little bit of that in Germany while you were there, and there will never be enough words. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone, for sharing those memories. As Kimberly and Stephanie were sharing about things they weren't sure their mom had heard about or Aunt Tammy had heard about, a lot comes out at memorial services as you're sharing memories. Oh, I don't think Mom knew that story or whatever. But those are great memories, and thank you guys all for sharing those with us today. And again, how the military is a big piece of David's life, obviously, and the life of his family. And as you know, he served very faithfully and honorably in the United States Army. David was with the 173rd Airborne Brigade as a paratrooper or sky soldier. And at this time, we are going to have David's military. David loved his country and served with pride. He loved his family and cared for them with all his heart. He loved his Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and is now with him in glory. We don't have answers as to the whys of David's passing so suddenly and so young, but we have a hope and a faith in the one who is in control of all things, including life and death. He is the one who can help us through such difficult times as these. And that's another reason that we need Jesus. If you don't know Jesus today, I encourage you to consider believing in him as David did, as the way, the truth, and the life. And if you'd like to do that, simply agree in your heart as I pray. I want to close our service committing David into the Lord's care. Will you pray with me? Dear Father, we know you love everyone here so very much. Your love is what prompted you to send your son down to earth to die for all our wrongs, our sins, and to provide a way for us to be forgiven and have a home in heaven one day. Indeed, Lord, that way is Jesus. David believed in Jesus, and many of us here do as well. We hold tightly to our hope in you. Lord, there may be some here who have decided just today that you are the way, the truth, and the life, and they want their sins forgiven. Lord, you know all our hearts, and you know those who are praying to you right now to accept you as Lord and Savior. Assure them of your love, grace, and mercy. Assure us all of those things. As we bring our service to a close, we thank you for this time to honor David, to remember him. We thank you for bringing your peace and comfort to our hearts today. And we now commit David into your care until we will see him again. Now go with us and bless our time of refreshments, visiting, and healing. Help us to carry on with grace and peace as you empower us. We ask this all in the precious name of Jesus Christ. Amen. I want to thank you all again for coming today to remember David, to pay tribute to him, to support and encourage the family. Appreciate you being here. And I invite all of you once again to the reception on the church grounds. It's going to be happening right now. So I just dismiss you with God's love and grace. Go in his peace today, and may he just permeate your conversations as you go. Thank you again for coming.